Hello students, today's topic for the lecture is UV-Vis Spectroscopy under Analytical Techniques. The reference is Organic Chemistry with Biological Applications by John E. McMurray, Chapter 10 and 11. In organic spectroscopy, first of all, we need to define the terms here. Now, what is spectroscopy? Take note of the word and spelling spectroscopy. It is a study of absorbance and or the emission of electromagnetic radiation by a particular molecule and the relationship of these properties with the details of the chemical structures of these molecules. What it means is when you shine a beam of light, be it whatever kinds of energy, the molecule will absorb this quantized amount of energy and undergoes a transition from a lower energy state to a higher energy state. And this is what we call absorption. Now, when it's of a high energy state, it becomes unstable without the sustained energy source. And after some time, it will emit this energy again and radiate this amount of energy, the same amount that it has absorbed previously. Remember, we cannot create nor destroy energy. We can only transform from one form to the other. So, all in all, spectroscopy means you absorb a certain amount of energy that's fixed, go up, and then come down again, absorption and emission. And there's some equations here to define for you how we calculate this amount of energy. So, E stands for energy. It is a product of Planck's constant and the frequency of the light source. Now, we break it down. Using the physics equation here, the energy could also be defined as a product of the Planck's constants and the velocity of light. Speed of light is 3 times 10 power of 8 meters per second divided by the wavelength of the light. And the last bit of revision here, the correlation between the frequency and the wavelength of a particular electromagnetic wave will be the product of the wavelength and frequency give you the speed of light. So we know that the speed of light is always constant. If I have a higher frequency of the light, means the wavelength must be lower. We know that electromagnetic waves range from a huge broad band of energy from radio wave all the way to gamma rays. So over on this side here, this is where the lower energy is. That's not harmful to us. Radio wave, we listen to the radio in the car at home sometimes. And these are the lower energy, hence lowest frequency, which means the wavelength must be the highest. Conversely, as we go on from microwave, infrared, UV visible light, ultraviolet, X-ray, all the way to gamma rays. You see here 10 power 20 frequency. In hertz, this is the SI unit for frequency. Super high frequency means it's very penetrating, highly energized, and on the other hand, very, very short wavelength. So over here, this narrow band indicates the visible light that we can see to us, our eyes, it is colored, the rainbow color. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. So how do you remember? Is red or orange which has a higher frequency or energy? You just have to check. Okay, red is closer to the infrared, which means it's of a what? Lower energy side. Compared to orange, orange is closer to violet, so it's going to be closer to ultraviolet. Higher energy, shorter wavelength. Now in this case, we're going to study three EM range. The UV, and this is for the UV visible spectroscopy, and the transition from a lower to a higher energy state is about the electronic energy level, so about electrons being promoted to higher energy state and then coming back again. The second one we're looking at is the infrared, in short IR, and this studies the vibrational energy of the molecule. So we know that molecules have covalent bonds, so they will stretch and vibrate. And lastly, for radio waves, the NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance, is about the nuclear spin state of the electrons. You know, we have the clockwise spin, anti-clockwise spin of electrons, right? How do we change it? How much energy is needed to overcome the external magnetic field? So now we go on to UV visible spectroscopy. Now, this is just a graph here to give you the relative energy levels of the different orbitals that is present in the system here. So as mentioned just now, UV visible spectroscopy is about promotion of electrons from lower to higher energy state. And on this axis here, you see this is sigma pi. N stands for non-bonding, pi star means the antibonding, sigma star is the antibonding orbital of the sigma bond. So you know previously about the bonding of a covalent bond. We have sigma bond, pi bond, right, delta bond. But at your level, we look at only the sigma bond and the pi bond. So the sigma bond is a stronger bond compared to the pi bond. So that's why when you form the bond, it releases more energy compared to the pi bond. You see? Right, it becomes more stable. So look at this CC single bond here. We have a sigma bond, which two electrons are being placed because you have one line. Remember, one line represents two electrons there. So if I want to transit, I need to push these electrons up to the same orbital, which is a sigma, but now it's the star. Star means an anti-bonding orbital. Anti-bonding means not bonding, which means if I give energy to this molecule with CC single bond, it will raise one electron up here and it will strain the bond. So in the long term, it will just break the bond. Okay, now when I look at CC double bond, it has got one sigma bond and one pi bond. So here you have two electrons in each of these sigma and the pi orbital for this molecule. If I pump in some energy, what happens is the pi electrons here will transit from the pi to the pi star, and this is what we understood because the pi bond is the weaker bond compared to the sigma bond. So if you give a bit of energy, who will break first? The pi bond will break first. And if you pump in more electrons here to this anti-bonding orbital, it will crack the pi bond. And if you have more energy, you will break both bonds. And if you take a look at C double bond O for structures such as carboxylic acid or ketone here, like in this case, acetone, propanone, there are lone pairs of electrons that are not drawn here, but there are on the oxygen. In fact, two pairs of lone electrons that's not used for bonding. And we call them non-bonding electrons. The letter N stands for them. So when we have energy pumped into this, the pi bond doesn't break first, while the lone pairs of electrons are being promoted, right, from the non-bonding orbital to pi star orbital. You may ask, why is this the case? Because the promotion of the electrons from a lower to higher energy state always occurs for the one that requires the lowest energy first. You see here, the gap between E1 and E2 for the orange color in C double bond is the smaller gap, so it requires lowest energy. Then the pink one, E1 to E2, which is the same for the blue one, E1 to E2, because you're just breaking a pi bond. Now if you look at the sigma bond here, you need so much energy to raise it to the other energy state. So here you observe and prove that for organic samples that are colorless, the UV absorption will be from 10 to 400 nanometers outside the range that we can see, and for visible it will be 400 to 750 nanometers, anything that's colored to us. And this pertains to alkenes and alkanes. Okay, this is propene, a form of alkene, the second member of the alkene series, and this is the UV visible spectra absorptivity against the wavelength. Okay, always look at the highest peak for UV-Vis spectroscopy. Highest peak, you look for the wavelength, that's the maximum absorption wavelength, okay, where the transition of the electrons takes place, most probably. If you take a look at acetone, the lambda max is how we denote it by chemists, right? It could range from 264 nanometers in water as a solvent to 279 nanometers for hexane. Now the highest probability of electronic transition in UV for acetone, remember the previous page? Which transition is easiest? The N to pi star, and Hence, you see here, this highest peak represent that transition for the lambda max. Okay. However, you know that this technique here is not a common technique to identify the functional group, because there could be similar CO double bond here present in the amide, ester, ketone, aldehyde, but you have very little ways to distinguish them. Let's look at benzene. Okay, for benzene, you have got CC double bond, which means you have pi bonds, pi to pi star electronic transition is being allowed. And the lambda max, you see so many peaks here because there's three pi bonds and many sigma bonds, so you have many, many layers. Recall that diagram just now, there's many possibility. But the one that's the highest absorption will be at 254 nanometers. Don't memorize this. As we progressively add methyl groups to benzene ring, so benzene, metabenzene, and xylene, okay? O stands for ortho-ortho xylene here. The electronic spectra is different, okay? But again, we do not use this to distinguish the different molecules, although we could in this case, but still we don't. But you know that from here, the different colors have a characteristic different spectra, so still, if you're lacking some other technique, you can use it to tell me that, okay, this belongs to benzene, that's for O-xylene, and that's for toluene. This is a table here to illustrate to you how does the maximum absorption wavelength relates to the structure of the molecules here. Okay, so you know that 220 for 2-methyl-butyl-1,2-diene, okay, they have conjugated pi bonds, pi, sigma, pi. Here we have pi, sigma, pi. But why is there a difference in a value? Because of the inherent structures, here is being enclosed in a six-member ring, and here it is open-ended, so there must be some difference in energy. The next case, hexa-1,3,5-triene, you notice that this energy is being raised, again, higher than the previous one, which is a double conjugated pi bond. So from here, you note that if I have a tetra in this conjugated pi, sigma, pi, sigma, pi, sigma, pi, conjugated ones, you should have a higher lambda max. Okay? Alright. This molecule is present in carrot. Carrot is very good for your eyes. Beta carotene is essential for you to see better, especially when you're young. So why is carrot orange in color? Because of beta carotene. See a link between the name? Carotene. Okay, and to explain why molecules are colored, we have to go back to the main molecular structure of the molecule that's present. So in beta carotene, we see a lot of conjugated pi system. When you say conjugated, means alternating pi and no pi bonds, sigma bonds. Conjugated, alternating pi and no pi bonds. So you see here, pi, no pi, 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 pi, all the way to the other side. So the more of these conjugated pi system that you have, the higher the maximum absorption wavelength. And this value corresponds to the red-orange color of the visible light that we can see, right? So because it falls in this visible region, that's why you can tell that it was colored. It's not colorless. Suppose carrot doesn't have this beta carotene, but it only has some other molecules that's only tri-conjugated, three pi bonds conjugated, then carrot would be colorless. Okay, thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.